How about playing something a little more down home that the folks know? How about Georgia, something like that? And play it. Yeah, give us a lot of melody for about a minute. And then then improvise a little, huh?
All right.
Yeah, I like that one.
Okay. I'll do it with a triplet feel. So it'll be one, two, three, four, with triplets. Okay? One, two, three, four.
This is the Nashville sound of Lenny Breau, guitarist, in the RCA Victor Studios. In charge of the session, Chet Atkins, producer. Recording Lenny Breau's first album. Lenny's sound is familiar to most Canadians through his exposure on CBC TV and radio. At the age of 26, he has matched the talents of Chet Atkins and is now perfecting his own jazz style. At six, he traveled with his father and mother, Hal Lone Pine and Betty Cody, across the United States and arrived in Winnipeg. Here and in Toronto, his jazz orientation took root.
Outside of just playing this, and it was written by Arthur Smith, who is known for the boogie woogie. It goes like this.
Lenny's music is new and exciting. When you hear his style, you hear jazz, country, intermingled with flamenco.
I worked on that style for about 3 years. But not because I wanted to be a real player of that kind of music, because it's not really a natural thing for me, being a country musician, but I like the kind of music. But I wanted to learn it because I wanted to apply the techniques to my own music, you know. So I learned things like, I had to learn this, you know. That was just a flamenco thing. And also this. It to jazz, you see, See, but I'm using this again, see? And it's the same thing that they do in flamenco. So that was the main reason. And I still like to play flamenco, but I like to mix the jazz in with it, which is kind of like breaking the rules. Thank you.
would you describe your music? In what terms?
Well, if I had to say something fast, I'd have to say it's just music, you see? But it's a combination of all the different kinds of music that I learned, all the country music years, and the jazz clubs, and the flamenco records I listened to, and the East Indian music records. It's a combination of all that that I like to inject into my jazz playing.
Did you?
So it would be hard to have one name for it, you know what I mean?
Did you start with country music?
Yes, I did start with country music.
When did you get your first guitar?
Let me see. I was about 8 years old. I started to play when I was six. I was living on a farm, and my mom and dad were on the road, you know, because my mom and dad were in the country field, and they were on the road, and they were on a tour, and the kid on the farm had a guitar, and I started to play the guitar. When my dad came back off the road, I had learned a few chords, you see, so I played the chords for him, and he bought me a guitar.
You had also the pleasure of working with Lenny's father and mother many years ago.
I sure did. I first heard of him, really, from them. I toured with them about 10, 12 years ago, and they used to talk about their son Lenny, who was then 11 or 12, and how he could play guitar and all that. Yeah, that's where I first heard of him.
Well, actually, by the age of 8 years old, I was serious about it then, because from very, like, even when I was three and four, at times I was backstage, and I'd be digging all the guitar players all the time. Like, my mom and dad had a guitar player with them back in those days, and I used to watch them all the time. So I knew that I wanted to play when I was eight, you see. So I'd watch, and I'd go backstage. I was living in Wheeling, West Virginia when I was 12, and I used to go backstage all the time and listen to all the guitar players, ask them questions. There was a guy there that played like Chet back in those days, and he helped me a lot, you know.
A lot of kids that started out playing, listening to my records, that may sound a little immodest, but it's the truth, but I knew eventually someone would come along that had modern ideas and everything, some young kid like Lenny who would really amaze the music world, and I think Lenny has done it.
I was living on the farm, like I said, I heard the radio one day, and I heard a guitar player playing. It sounded like two guys playing at the same time. And I didn't believe that he was playing his rhythm and his melody at the same time, because I had never heard of anybody doing that. And it stuck in my head, and I went out and bought a record and listened to it, and I thought it was a trick recording at first. Then when I met this guy in Wheeling, and I saw him do it, he had taken a few lessons from Chet. You know, I had made up my mind that I had to learn to play that way, you know. So I started at 12, buying all of Chet's records and listening to them. And I spent a good 8 years on just that particular style of playing.
Do you do this mostly by ear?
That's about the only way you can learn how to play like Chet is by ear, because that's how he plays.
Yeah, he plays a lot of my licks, but he's modern with them. I'm kind of old-fashioned and squire, you know. But he plays the harmonics that I do. I originated that, but he does it a lot better than I do.
I'm going to sing a song now called Time After Time.
can spot people with talent, and not bragging, but I can, and I admire people like that so much when I run across somebody that's so creative, and he's a very creative person, and so I dig him. I dig anybody that's creative.
Well, like I say, like working in the jazz clubs was great for me. It was like going to school. It was like going to school, because I was in there at least I was there every night in the week almost for about a year. Also, all the experience I had in the CBC studios was great for me, because I learned how to read. I had to learn how to read, because a lot of times there's a time limit. You have to get things done, and you know, within a certain time. And if you don't read, you don't get it done. But luckily, I got a good ear. And so even when I didn't know how to read, if I learned the part, like if I heard the part once, I'd memorize it anyway. I don't practice as much as I used to anymore, because I don't have that kind of time anymore. But when I was younger, going to school, I'd bring my guitar to school, and I used to practice at recess time, because, and then when I left school in the ninth grade, because I had to make up my mind whether I was going to play in the clubs at night or whether I was going to go to school, because I was getting home pretty late, and I just couldn't make it in school well, you see.
Lenny is a fascinating character to watch perform. He isolates himself and merges with the guitar. Facial expressions bring out the intensity of his involvement with his music. Basically shy, he enjoys playing for an audience.
It all depends how the audience is reacting to me. I enjoy working in a coffee house, even though they're young kids that come there, but they come there to listen. And their minds are really open, so that I know what they like, so I'll play what they like, and then I'll play what I like, and then they're ready for it, you see. Otherwise, if I went out and played a jazz tune right at the beginning of the set, it wouldn't be interesting enough, you see what I mean? But I have to build up to that, so I'll open with a folk tune, maybe a tune written by Bob Dylan, because they know Bob Dylan, and they can associate with the melody, and eventually, I lead into my own things. I enjoy working with an audience, because usually it makes me play better.
One cannot simply state jazz. There's the feelings of the artist, communication with the audience, and the atmosphere at the time of playing. The music runs the gamut from blues to ballad, up-tempo, and swing.
Take, for instance, what I was playing at the beginning. I was playing... But that's not blue, you see. But if I was to play it as a ballad, like this, then it's bluer, you know? So Nashville, it has to come down in tempo. It has to move slow, you see. Otherwise, it's a happy feeling. See? So that's how it's done, or else if you want it to be extra lively, then you know. Mm-hmm. It all depends how you feel right then and there when it comes to playing jazz. Like, if you want it to be in a spontaneous way, it all depends how you feel. So what I try and do when I play is not stay in any one mood too long, because an audience can get tired of one mood all night, you know, like playing with the same type of... I try to keep the moods going all the time, you see.
I first heard of him when some of the guitar players with the bands out of Nashville traveled up in Canada, and they heard him in Winnipeg, and a boy by the name of Paul Yandel that works with Johnny and Jack, Kitty Wells, brought me a tape on Lenny. That's the first time I ever heard him, about a year ago, I guess.
Being able to make the record here meant a lot, because it meant that it would be more relaxed, rather than going to some big place and doing it, like New York, where everything is moving so fast.
Nashville, Tennessee is filled with character. The Parthenon, a miniature of the original in Greece, thus the pseudonym Athens of the South. 17th Avenue in Nashville is called Music Row, a redevelopment project, for this multi-million dollar business has indeed given new life to Nashville. The Country Hall of Fame pays tribute to the country music industry, which has had 40 years of development. Here is where itinerant musicians travel with hope of fame and glory on the grand old Opry stage. Magnolias sprout in every yard, and there's the familiar phrase on the lips of Nashville citizens, "You all come back, you hear?" Once known as the country music capital, it now includes all types of music under the label The Nashville Sound, the feel for originality and creativity. Lenny Breau is part of this new era.
Well, there was a time when I would have been afraid to record in Nashville because I wanted to be known as a jazz player. But now I don't really care what I'm called as the player, you know, because I feel it's just music now. And so I don't necessarily have to be tagged as any kind of player, as a jazz player or a country player. I think it's just a combination of everything I'd like to be known as, you see. So I don't mind doing the record down here for that reason.
A recording session, a maze of technical equipment and the people involved, each with a specific role to play. Lenny, the creator. Producer, Chet Atkins. In charge of the session, Danny Davis. Recording technician, Bill Vanderwert. Publicity Director, Wally Cochran. Lenny's personal choice of sidemen for the session. Ron Halderson, bass guitar. And Reg Kelm, drums, both from Winnipeg. Thank you.
I think his biggest audience will be guitar players for a while, because that's the way all great artists start. It kind of tends to be an underground sort of thing, and then like a Roger Miller, he was the hottest guy in Nashville for years before the record buying public caught on to him.
He has a very commercial sound. Let me say this, when I say he has a commercial sound, I have to be realistic. First off, all the musicians in the United States will listen and like and purchase this boy from a layman standpoint. He's so terrific. He's just a tremendous musician. And I think that you have to go beyond that point. This has been proven many times. The public buys what they hear and like, and so therefore it's up to us to get beyond this musician standpoint, and so therefore this is why we work a little bit harder.
Recorded in one or two takes, no written music, and few errors. The length of the tunes, 5 to 7 minutes, were too long for use on radio stations. This will take up too much time for on-air use. The technicians have to edit the master tapes. To do this alone takes an expert.
Well, that'll be the biggest problem, because as you know, we recorded much too much for an album. So it's all good. We got to get in there and listen and decide what 40 minutes to release. We must have an hour and a half. So that's a little chore I'll have to do. Mm-hmm. And we'll edit it and make any splicing that needs to be done. And then we get the cover and the works and the liner and all that. And it'll be released in a few months.
In this particular case, this would be shipped to every good music and jazz and cottage station in the United States, which would consist of about 3,200 radio stations.
You have to select the jazz stations.
We don't necessarily. We send it, even though, as I say, that this is sent, we send it basically to all stations, but we don't. We try to get it into the college radio stations because the kids seem to know what's happening. Secondly, you have a wealth of a lot of stations that are classified as rhythm and blues stations. But they devote about an hour and a half a day to jazz. In this particular case, this would be a natural for them. It would be something that they could talk about, a new artist. And this is where an artist grows from, really. As the public, American public, buy on impulse. So, you know, it's... So we try to give them the impulse, the feel, the sound that they want, something new.
This is the sound of Lenny Breau's first album. What about his future? Where does he go from here?
I think he needs to get in a big area like New York, Hollywood, or somewhere where the right people can hear him.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think his potential is unlimited. And he could stay here in Nashville and be a great guitar player on sessions, but he would be buried here, like a lot of us.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd like to see him get in New York or Hollywood, where he can get on a lot of coast-to-coast TV shows.